Hello and welcome everybody to the first of our classics live broadcastings. You Nordic Combined fans out there have voted and of course you get what you've wanted. Today we're gonna take you back to 2012 because this competition has won the first poll with 60-40%. My name is Luis Huluch and I'm inviting you to this trip, not only to the beautiful Trentino we are watching here in the first impressions right now, but also to this first trip to the past. Surrounded by the wonderful Dolomites mountains, we will now watch the third World Cup competition we have had in 2012 here in the beautiful Val di Fiemme. And as you have already seen in the poll, it was very special for one of the most successful Nordic combiners in this era, Akito Watabe. So, Trentino is not only a touristic but also a very active and sport passionate region in the heart of the Alps, and we are here at the Trampolino Giuseppe d'Alben in Predazzo, the entry village of Val di Fiemme, which will host the 2013 World Championships, as we are talking from the 2012 perspective, obviously, but speaking from today's future, from 2020, we will have Olympic events here for the first time in 2026, since the Val di Fiemme is one of the venues for the Olympic Games in Milano and Cortina. So, where are we actually? We have to remind ourselves, we are in the third period of the 2011-2012 World Cup season. This is the 14th of the 23 World Cup events, and of course we are always comparing it a bit to the present. We have had only 17 of those in the past season. So, yeah, Nordic Combined definitely has had one of the healthier years back from where we are watching right now. And some things were a bit different here. We see a lot of Ottesen, today's race director, Nordic Combined. Back then, he was the Nordic Combined coordinator, just below Ulrich Wehling, who was race director back then. And yeah, already in his last season in this meaningful function, he took Nordic Combined definitely to a different level. And for the last time in his function, he was here in Val di Fiemme. Obviously, the faces may be not too familiar for those of you who have discovered their passion for Nordic Combined only a few years ago. So we will definitely also have the time and take the opportunity to introduce you to some faces you may not know. Obviously, with this guy here, Johannes Ritzig, it's a little different.
Yes.
Also, Lukas Rungald here should say something to you as you're watching Nordic Combined more frequently. And it's going to be an interesting trip, that's for sure. Some things were different, as I mentioned before, as we are having here the view down the stadium. A first difference between this event we are watching right now and the present is that actually the large hill could be used, which was not possible this past season, 2019-2020, due to an avalanche which has caused a bit of damage down the outrun. So the events had to be held on the next smaller hill. You can see on the left-hand side the normal hill. But back then we were jumping on this K120 meters ski jump, which has a hill size of 134 meters in this event. Lasse Ottesen carefully having a look on the circumstances we're seeing right now. and right before this event, which was held on a Sunday, we saw the so-called penalty race back then. Yeah, that was a format that existed for two seasons back in the day, which was won by Jason Lamy-Chapuis. He also is the current World Cup leader with 856 points ahead of Alessandro Pitin, 674, and Akito Watabe, 573. And the conditions actually could not be better. We have a light headwind, so perfectly for ski jumping actually, even though it's very, very cold on this 5th of February 2012. Once again, we are having the look on the Lachil. But despite the cold temperature, it's definitely a perfect day for having a Nordic Combined event. And it's also a special event due to the fact that we are going to experience the World Championships in 2013. So less than 1 year to go until then, and this is going to be the last test event for that. Val di Fiemme, for the third time in history, is going to be a World Championships host. That was the case before in 2003 and also in 1991. And this was actually a special episode of this great event due to the fact that Nordic Combined legend and Eurosport colleague Hans-Peter Pohl was a participant in there. He finished fifth in the individual event, which was held on the Normal Hill and 15 kilometers Gundersen effort, and fourth with the team, also from the Normal Hill, and in 3x10 kilometers race. So 21 years before this event, things were much more different than they were in 2012. So here you can see the start list. As I've mentioned, some names may be familiar, some have to be familiar, and some might not be familiar, but that's the case. 55 competitors from 12 different nations were among the starters, and 15 of them are still active. So these definitely should ring a bell in your brain if you are a real Nordic Combined fan. So we are only a very few moments ahead of the start, so obviously very excited for that. So let's take this trip back to the past. I hope you enjoy this format as much as we do, and we can already promise we have some more great things coming up also in our other FIS disciplines. So whatever sport you prefer, definitely make sure you tune in. So the athletes are preparing for the start of this event. And especially for those of you who haven't been watching Nordic Combined back then, it is kind of easy to understand how this thing works, because the method itself, the Gundersen method itself, has not changed ever since. This would have been a slight difference if we would have chosen the penalty race, a non-existing format, which was held on Friday, as I've mentioned before, and on Saturday, so the day before this event, we saw a team sprint competition, so this is also familiar, but this penalty race was certainly a very, very unique event. So it's gate 8.5 for this young man we see right here. This is Samuel Costa, one of those 15 athletes, so you can write your checklist from now on. This was actually the weekend of his World Cup debut, the third of the 3 days for him, so we can now compare this jump to his K1 capabilities at the moment. And he's setting the first benchmark in this event with his jump on 108 meters. As you can see, also the wind and gait calculation and compensation is in use. That was implemented in the 2010-2011 season. So already a familiar thing to have these days. And the young Samuel Costa, only 20 years of age back then, shows us that he's kind of happy with what he has achieved. Mattia Rungaldia, the second name surely familiar to all of us. But Mattia, not amongst the active Nordic Combiners anymore, is actually the younger brother of Elena Rungaldia, who recently announced her retirement from ski jumping. And Mattia nowadays is a kids coach in the beautiful Val Gardena, not too far away from Val di Fiemme. Up next is Sergei Maslenikov from Russia. Had a very successful appearance to Italy actually in 2006, where he finished 10th at the Olympic Games in Pragelato. 2012, he was 29 years of age. And as you can see, quite a formidable jumper, even though he was not too happy with this jump. 111 meters. And you can also follow it on the values of the width calculation. It's just a perfect day, perfect calm day for ski jumping. Random applause up there from the coaches though for his performance at the intermediate lead. Truls Sønstehagen Johansen from Norway celebrated 8 Continental Cup victories back in the day. In 2009 he won gold with the team at the Junior World Ski Championships. But unfortunately never really made the breakthrough in the seniors course, in the senior circuit. 105.5 meters for the 20-year-old back then from Oslo. And jumping the famous Elan skis from Slovenia, which also do not exist in this shape anymore nowadays. As you probably know, this company is called Sladnar. Hideaki Nagai, the second of the still active guys. And shows us the first jump close to the K-point line. 20 years of age he was back then, and one thing that never has changed until today, unfortunately, he never scored a podium in the World Cup or a medal at great events, but it's still great to follow him along his way. A very passionate guy, and always gives us a special flavor. And I'm sure you all know this guy right here, Mario Seidel, only 19 years of age back then. Also made his World Cup debut right here in Val di Fiemme on this weekend. And he was already a very strong ski jumper, as he shows us with this performance. 124.5 meters, and for the first time there's a bit of atmosphere here in the stadium. And do you recall the days where Atomic was amongst the ski jumping ski manufacturers? Well then, you are certainly at least above teenage years for sure. Marian Jelenko from Slovenia. Also good performance from the gold and silver medalists from the youth, from the junior wet ski championships in Otepää 2011. Typical Slovenian jumping style, very aggressive, very based on aerodynamics. And rank number two for the 20-year-old from Vilnius. Nicolas Martin, the first of the back then very successful French team. Not a familiar face to all of us for sure. Which was also due to the fact that his jumping skills weren't really on the highest world-class level, you could say. Definitely one of the weaker amongst the athletes. Eighth and last position for now. And we can already spoiler, he won't gain too much ranks in course of this competition. Lukáš Havranek from Czech Republic, also a new face, back then only 20 years of age. Definitely some good essentials in the ski jumping part, but as it is also today, you also have to be skilled in cross country, obviously, and so he never managed to score a point in his World Cup career, unfortunately. But as we will get to know in course of this event, the Czech team was slightly bigger as it is today. Filip Orta, another of those debutants back then, the youngest of them, 18 years old only. But you could also see he was already possible to beat some of his older opponents. Sixth place. But you can see the gaps are already opening up. 1:32 for him. And obviously it is not getting any smaller in this event. Mikko Leinonen from Finland. Finnish team, let's say solid in this phase. He also was an Olympian 2 years after the event we are watching right now. That was in Sochi, where he finished 40th and 42nd. As it is usual today, the starting order obviously depending on the World Cup ranking, and he hasn't scored a single point in this season up until this event. Shun Yamamoto, familiar surname, but it's not Ryota and neither Go Yamamoto we are watching, but it's Shun. And obviously not too happy about his own performance. 112.5 meters for the student from the Oyama High School. And takes the spots six ahead of Filip Orta. Another one of the local heroes, Giuseppe Michieli. Italian at the Olympic Games in Torino, the up-to-date last Italian home games, with rank number 14 in the individual event and 16th in the sprint. 110 meters for the local. Also not too happy about his own performance, basically lost a bit of the timing there at the takeoff, and so it will be a long, long way for him later in the cross-country race. And he immediately knows it, of course. Tobias Kammerlander from Austria, a former student of the ski college Saalfelden. Styria, which recently brought such great talent as Marita Kramer in women's ski jumping, for instance, World Cup winner in January in Sapporo. And those ski colleges in Austria have a great traditions in finding and then building talents. And also Kammerlander was a promising young athlete, even though didn't make quite the cuts to the world class. Jim Hatul from Finland. In total, Nordic disciplines were in much better shape in Finland back then. A smooth takeoff from him. For the man from Lahti, who has been coached by the legendary Hannu Manninen, who might occur in this series, also in his great time as an athlete. We will see as we are moving now to Taylor Fletcher, the fifth of those guys who are still competing. The only American who is left from that generation. As you can see, he also was much closer to the top of the game on the ski jumping hill, and this immediately resulted in a good reaction from him. But it's unfortunately got rare to see him jumping very close to the K point line. Of course, we still see him smiling sometimes. It's getting there, he says. Yeah, well, let's hope he will be able to say that again as soon as somehow possible. He really would deserve that. Janis Moorweiser from Germany. A promising young German. Back in the day, he won gold, silver and bronze at his home Junior World Ski Championships in Hintertshagen 2010. But it should not take much longer than 2 years from this event on until he sadly retired from the sport, because he was not able to transfer these performances in a steady and stable way to the seniors level. But in the intermediate time right now, he is ranked second behind Mario Seidel. Ivan Panin from Russia. And this is a great jump from the man from Leninogorsk, who also used the opportunity to compete at his home Olympics in Sochi 2014. Only finished 43rd from the large hill, and then retired, at least internationally. But what seems very likely in this event that the Russians will be able to score World Cup points, yeah, was not really the case in the past season. Tomasz Slavik, already 13 years old, we have to say, because so far this is the oldest competitor we are seeing. And he's definitely using his experience in this jump. The gold Universiade winner of 2007. That was the edition in Pragelato. So he won the title of the student world champion with that event, and now is being ranked fourth. And up next is also already his country fella, Miroslav Dvořák from Liberec. Three times bronze at the Junior World Ski Championships. He has won until then. And even a Continental Cup competition, which was in 2009 in Bischofshofen actually. Also a thing to hear about, which rarely happens this year. So also in terms of the hosts for several events, there were definitely some minor but also some major changes. Mitja Oranic for Slovenia also won one Continental Cup in his career. That was in Krain, in his home country, even in the town where he was born. Two times Olympian. And now jumping 115.5 meters. And of course, as a Slovene, it is a duty to jump your home skis. Elan, obviously. Yeah, Mario Seidel clearly enjoying himself in this position. In the past events he was competing, unfortunately not too many because of his torn ACLs, but if that was the case, he wasn't really present in the leader's box for a long time, because obviously he was not up front in the starting order. But that was different in this era. There we see the replay of Tim Hook's jump, the last Swissman that actually could be counted as a world-class athlete in this discipline. Nowadays, Switzerland only has one competitor in this discipline, which is Pascal Müller, who also competed at the past Junior World Ski Championships in Oberwiesenthal 2020, but that's basically it about Swiss Nordic Combined. Unfortunately, Pavel Churavý from Czech Republic. Very extraordinary jumping style we see from the 34-year-old Czech at that time, also a man from Liberec, the World Championships host of 2009, as some of you might remember. 116 meters. But if it's working, it's also good, at least in terms of the results, obviously. A rank number 11 in that very moment. And we even see a second Swissman, Sepi Hurschler, 27 years old, 34th in the World Cup ranking at that time, so even slightly better than Tim Hook. An okay jump, but not more for Hurschler, who finished 9 times inside the top 10 in the World Cup in his career, and also 22nd and 24th at the Torino 2006 Olympic Games. For the moment, he is definitely inside the pack. For the cross country race later on. Tahei Kato for Japan. Also a very good jump from him, for the 2060-year-old from Sapporo, who became team world champion in Liberec in 2009, 121 meters. And as you could see in the background, the grandstand is still under construction. And those works got finished within the 1 year that was remaining until the big event actually was following. And once again, the home crowd is required to make some noise for Armin Bauer from Valgardena. One Continental Cup win in his career. But that was an unsatisfying work shift for him. Only 103.5 meters, even though the wind conditions are still fine, still fair, and still sound. Yeah, and he's definitely at the tail of the field. And there we see Gudmund Storlien from Norway. Here, four medals at the Junior World Ski Championship in his career. And still a good jump after having a bit of an issue in the middle of the flight phase there. Timing wise, well executed. And then he steps himself on the back of the ski, I think. But still made a great save. And puts on this jump. There we see Nick Huber, who was still the jumping coach of the Norwegians. 122 meters and the fifth place for Storlien. Manuel Feist.
Aus Deutschland, mit Stand 28 schon in Luft, Manuel.
And this is a great jump from the 19-year-old from Bayersbronn. At that time also his sister Melanie was still active in ski jumping. 125.5 meters for the young man who was about to score his first World Cup podium 6 years after this event. Could you imagine that by just seeing this jump? Well, the fact books tell the truth. There we see the first watabe. It's Yoshito. And ever since, the relationship between him and his brother hasn't changed. It always has been the same. And always the fact that Yoshito definitely is a stronger ski jumper than a cross-country skier. 121 meters for Watabe. Started practicing Nordic Combined also because of his brother. He says he always wanted to be better than him, and this fight lasts on until today and hopefully even longer. Bib number 30 is Thomas Drummel from Austria. Jumping for Achomitz. Back in the day, 112.5 meters for the 22-year-old who now is a passionate and professional videographer, actually. Definitely should check out what he is doing these days in social media. Very impressive works you can see from him. Definitely easy on the eyes. François Bro. I'm pretty sure he had no idea what was coming up within 1 year of time. he would be celebrating a gold medal with the team next year, and he already set a good essential for that by smoothly adapting to the circumstances, to the ski jumping hill, to the venues. It shows us a nice jump right here. 24 years young he was back then, the man from Chamonix, the first ever host of Olympic Games, and he definitely gets criticized for his landing technique from his coach, but well, second place, not too bad, as you definitely could conclude. Johnny Spillane from the Steamboat Springs, Colorado.
Winter Sports Center, Johnny Spillane.
Also, a good jump from him. 31 years of age he was already then. But this event was just 2 years after he scored 3 times silver medal in Vancouver at the Olympic Games. And definitely the coach's tower is delighted with what the athletes are delivering here on the ski jumping hill so far. Yusuke Minato from Tokyo. Also, he surely didn't know that he would miss a bronze medal with his team by only 1.5 seconds the next year. He quite a well-balanced Nordic combiner for that time, equally good in ski jumping and cross-country skiing. 118 meters for him. Slightly having issues there at the telemark. Obviously also the judges recognize that. And there we see Brian Fletcher, the older of the Fletcher brothers. And that is definitely a good day at the office for the US-American team. 124 meters. And that was also a very good season for him, because he finished it with his first and only World Cup victory at no other place than the legendary Holmenkollen in Oslo, actually. And we can just hope and wish that the US team will get back to a similar level as they have had back in these days. And Maxime Lahure for France. And this is giving him the intermediate lead for now. Pretty sure about that. Also, he won the team gold just 1 year after this competition. And another 2 years later, in 2015 in Falun, Sweden, he took bronze with Team France, which was his last major success in his great career. So, in only 20 more competitors to come, as we see the intermediate standing. So, Lahert leading ahead of Feist, Bro, Fletcher and Seidel. Very close out there in the front, the first 13 competitors within 40 seconds, the first 15 within inside 50 seconds. So, we will see lots of great action in the cross-country track, I can already tell you.
Ancora no, quindi vuol dire che ti devi applicare ancora di più.
Va bene,
grazie.
But still for now the field itself is quite close in itself, considering that the first and the last are only 2 minutes and 49 seconds apart from each other. That's slightly different these days. And definitely was delivering some tension and excitement. The wind luckily is being stable at the moment as we are continuing now with Bill Simong, the first ever US Nordic gold medalist at the Olympic Games, has definitely left a footprint, not only Nordic Combined, but also in skiing history with that. And nowadays is an important man at the USA Nordic organization, as he is the executive director, so responsible for the three Nordic sports.
USA
and delivering a good jump on 122.5 meters and taking seventh position. The small crowd wakes up again for Lukas Rungaldia. In only his 10th year as a Nordic athlete, actually started with cross-country skiing in the age of 14 and then switched to Nordic Combined in the age of only 16. So it took a bit of a while until he found the right sport for him, even though it also gives him such days as this one, unfortunately, a very frustrating one. Johannes Rizek, only 20 years young back then, but definitely plays already a solid part in this family. The man from Oberstdorf, who definitely has a special place for Val di Fiemme in his heart, and actually took his 17th and up-to-date last World Cup victory right here. That was in 2019, so a bit less than 1.5 years ago. Even though he was not too happy about this jump, still his halftime position is certainly not the worst for him. Janne Rinnanen from Rovaniemi, Finland. And also he is doing a great job on the trampolino. Giuseppe Dalben always needed a good ski jump in order to have even the chance to fight for a proper result. The team world champion from Sapporo 2007 is taking fifth position. And now we see a treble of Austrian Nordic combiners. The first of them is Rudi Denifel from the Stubai Valley, as we can already see on his helmet. Faithful sponsor. On top of his head, 121 and a half meters for the Tyrolean, who was one of only very few Nordic combiners that also were active on ski flying hills, actually. Falco Kirstmeier, the jumping coach back then. And also Willy himself with mixed emotions about this jump. And there we see the current Austrian head coach, Christoph Bieler, in the young age of only 34 years. And look at this jump. He always was able to deliver some nice flights, as he showed us with this one. And his fan club surely happy about their appearance right here. 126 meters for Bieler, as they call him. And he's clearly enjoying himself, taking the lead with this result. And also Mario Seidel was still up in the mix there. And the third of the three Austrians we are seeing right now is Mario Stecher, nowadays the sporting director in the Austrian Ski Federation. It would be so interesting to experience and hear how these athletes would look back on their performances, most likely not too different from their reactions after the performances themselves. Next is Sébastien Lacroix from Beaudemont. Also he getting himself into the groove for what was coming up the year after. He won two times team gold and everyone that visits this arena can see his name written on the board of champions that was installed at the back of the grandstand. Jürgen Grobak definitely should ring a bell to every one of you. Only 20 years young he was back then, but this was his breakthrough season. The youngest athlete inside the top 15 in the World Cup ranking. So, for him we can conclude he is almost a decade-long part of the very top of Nordic Combined. And the first initial signs could already be seen in his performance in this event. Jan Schmid. His retirement not too long ago, that was April 2019, so just a bit longer than 1 year ago. Good performance in this jump, but also a very good performance in his last career highlights. Team gold, he won at the World Championships in Seefeld, so he definitely ended his career on a high, was not too expectable. He was already 35 years old when he retired. And definitely also did that with two thumbs up, just as right here in this current picture. Christoph Bieler carefully looking on what will come up soon, as we are having one last look on the intermediate standing. So three Austrians inside the top 10, also two Germans and two Frenchmen. 10th place still belonging to Ivan Palin. A very unused picture if you follow Nordic Combined for maybe the last 5 years, or even shorter, obviously. Unfortunately, Italians not having a good day, as we see in this last part of the result graphics, but spoiler alert, the best Italian is yet to come. Definitely a pleasure to watch Christoph Bieler's jump once again. And I'm pretty sure everyone out there that is watching is very curious to see on which position he's going to end this jumping round, and obviously also on which position he's going to end this overall competition, because of course the cross-country part will follow directly after this ski jumping competition, as we now heading on with the top 10 that were present in this event. This is Fabian Riesle for Germany. Also for him it was a breakthrough season. Scored his first two World Cup podiums in 2012. Both actually at Chonef on both days. The German staff not entirely happy with his performance, but one thing that hasn't changed ever since then is that Riesle is definitely one of the strongest cross-country racers. Bernhard Gruber, the oldest remaining veteran from this competition. And he definitely drops a burly bomb with this jump. A great effort for the representative of the ski club Bischofshofen. 127 meters, the longest jump so far. And this is definitely going to be difficult to beat for everyone who is coming up. And of course, the satisfaction up there is definitely high, and he takes the lead from Christoph Bieler. Magnus Hofdahl-Mohr. This man actually doesn't really need an introduction. We can always point out that the way he appeared everywhere, mainly on the cross-country course, we must say, definitely brought a special flavor to Nordic Combined. Always struggled a little bit on the ski jumping hill, but if he was able to show a good jump, it definitely had to count him to the favorites for a victory. But not today, unfortunately, even though the gap to the front with 1 minute 56 is not that big, we must say. So also make sure to follow him along his way on the cross-country course later on. Jörn Kircheisen, 17 World Cup victories, 4 medals at the Olympic Games, and team world champion in 2017. But as much as a major success was possible for him, also a slightly disappointing attempt could happen for him, only 112 meters. And yeah, he's definitely right in the big mix of the cross-country pack we will see later on. So, Erik Frenzel, a living and still active Nordic Combined legend, obviously. And the 23-year-old Erik Frenzel was definitely a very strong ski jumper. 1 year before this event, he won his first World Championship title in no other place than Oslo, and 1 year later, right here in Val di Fiemme, he was striking again and winning the large hill competition. And with seventh place, he definitely had a good essential to start in the second half of this competition. Mikko Kokstien scored 5 medals at World Ski Championships, but not here. That was the only World Championship edition he possibly could have reached during his career, but he was not participating yet. And so big success here in Val di Fiemme did not happen for him. Still, 120.5 meters. A good jump for the Norwegian. And his stronger discipline with the cross country is definitely to come up, which is also why he was kind of satisfied with this result. Tino Edelmann, at that time with rank number 4, the best German in the World Cup ranking. And now is taking the lead with this great job. The man who has won bronze in the team sprint with Erik Frenzel the year after, 128.5 meters. And they definitely showed why this success was coming up very, very soon. They both very familiar and good adapted to this ski jump. And so Edelmann is definitely in a promising position. And there we see the man of this day. It is Akito Watabe. And he is dropping a phenomenal jump, the longest of the competition, with 23 years of age, 133.5 meters, so only half a meter below hill's height. And so he did the best possible first half of the job in order to secure the first of his 18 World Cup victories on this day, Sunday the 5th of February 2012. Yes. And this reaction should become very familiar to all of us within the last 8 years. Alessandro Pitin. As I pointed out, the best Italian at that time, second in the overall World Cup ranking, won the first ever medal for Italy in Nordic Combined. That was bronze in Vancouver 2010. But it never really changed that he was always preferring the smaller hills because the gap to the front after his ski jumping performances was always a bit smaller. And there we see Jason Lamy-Chapuis. He definitely was on top of his game at that time. 5 victories in that season over a World Cup winner. A small hiccup there at the landing. But it was just an outstanding time he has had in that period, which was crowned by 3 gold medals just 1 year after this event right here in Predazzo. Gold in the individual on the normal hill, also with the team, and then also from the large hill with the team. And there we see the fist pump from Akito Watabe, who was taking the victory in this jumping ground, 20 seconds ahead of Thiel Edelmann, 31 ahead of Bernard Gruber, and then comes Christoph Bieler ahead of the best 2 Frenchmen, Lahert and Chapuis, and there's even a third inside the top 10. And you can see how close this competition actually is, how small the margin between each and every athlete, points but also gap wise. So the first 34 athletes within 2 minutes, and this provides definitely lots of tension, lots of fights, and lots of excitement for the cross country race, which will follow right now. We are enjoying the best bits of this competition. So Bernhard Gruber taking 3rd position, 29 years of age back then. Tino Edelmann, 26 years old, from Thuringia, on 2nd place, 20 seconds behind Akito Watabe, who was one of the most active Nordic combiners actually when it came to his voting. Saw several posts of him in his social media asking his friends to vote for this competition. And obviously, dear Akito, if you're watching this, you have very faithful and engaged fans. We're closely listening and reading to what you are saying. So yeah, this is definitely also to his fans that this competition actually has been winning the first of our 5 poles in this small series. So this is the view on the stadium. The spectators will now make their way to the cross-country stadium at Lago di Tesero. And we will just make a very short cut, short switch, and then we will be right back with the second half of this competition in only a very few moments. So no real break we're going to have, because obviously this competition was still on our tape, so we don't need to wait as long as in real life back then until we start with the cross-country race. 10 kilometers it will be, even though the break between the end of this competition and the start of the second part was only about 1.5 hours. But in this case, it will be just 1.5 minutes until we are actually back with the cross-country race. And we can also guarantee you that this is going to be very interesting to watch, to find out what's maybe similar to the present and what has changed ever since. And of course, also how the end result will look like. So, and there we are at Stadio Lago di Tesero for the second half of this individual Gundersen World Cup competition, the 13th of the 2011-2012 World Cup season in Nordic Combined. And as usual, once again, we're going to see the highlights of the top three jumpers. Bernhard Gruber from Austria will start in third position after his attempt on the ski jumping hill with a gap of 31 seconds to the top. Second in the jumping round became Tino Edelmann. His gap to the leader, 20 seconds, and the leader itself, the winner of the ski jumping round, but also, yes, we can spoiler it this time, the winner of this competition, Akito Watabe. And obviously, don't be mad if we spoiled it due to the fact that this was actually the aspect we gave you in order to vote for your favorite competition. And this one has won by 60-40% in the poll against Jason Lamy-Chapuis's home victory in Schoneff. So there we see the profile of the cross-country track. It has a course length of 2.5 kilometers, so the athletes will have to ski it four times in total. Like in the first half, we see the maximum climb of 33 meters. The total climb on this lap is 93 meters, and the height difference between the lowest and the highest point is 43 meters. But mind you that we are around 1,000 meters above sea level. So it's definitely also a challenge for the lungs, for the endurance capacities. And we are very curious to see who's going to make it. The weather has just brightened up ever since we have finished the jumping competition. The sun came out, and so it got slightly warmer, minus 8 degrees Celsius compared to minus 10 in the morning. And that is the start list for this cross-country race. The first seven athletes within 1 minute. And interestingly, this field is much closer as it was this year, where we jumped on the normal hill. That's because the gap between the best and the worst on the jumping hill was smaller than it was on the normal hill, actually. As surprisingly as this might occur, but that's how it is. And we still conclude all 55 athletes are on the start list, but you can also see from Samuel Costa with bib number 50 on, the wave start will be used, even though these athletes have a bigger gap to the top, meaning Costa has 2 minutes 52 seconds, Johansson with bib number 51, 3 minutes 14, Mattia Rungaldia 3 minutes 26, Armin Bauer and Lukas Rungaldia with 3 minutes 34, and Nicolas Martin from France with 3 minutes 42, but the margin time between the wave start and their original time will be added towards their final time as soon as they arrive the finish, just to make this event not become too long for the spectators. And we also see that all of the athletes are present, so there we go, Akito Watabe leaves the stadium, and if he didn't know that he was going to win this race, he at least had a good feeling about it after winning the jumping round and leading the whole field. Tino Edelmann is now also on their way, as Bernhard Gruber now departs from the start area. Austria's head coach Christoph Bieler on fourth position, and then we already see the strong French guys with Maxime Lahert and Jason Lamy-Chaprier very close to each other, but also Francois Brault will be up there, so it's going to be a German and French train that will form itself in just a very few seconds. And also the gaps afterwards are very, very small, so be prepared for some large groups appearing on this cross-country track. Not only in the midfield, as it is a common picture in today's time, but also at the very top, because the gaps up there in front are too close. Also having 55 competitors in Nordic Combined World Cup was back then more common than it is actually these days. But that's mainly because also the general level inside the circus, inside the competitors' field, has grown so much ever since these days. And also Magnus Moan is going to make his way. So, and in less than 10 seconds, every athlete has made a start with grip number 49 here. We saw Alessandro Pittin, the local hero, the hope for a great Italian result, but that great result might not occur, as this gap for him is slightly too big to the top. Well, Akito Watabe at the moment has a lonely race. And at that time we didn't know what major successes this guy is going to reach. He became the second Japanese after Kenji Ogiwara to win the Crystal Globe in Nordic Combined. And even made a first place last season, that was in Trondheim in Norway. Totally unexpected. Didn't really have the strongest of his seasons, but that was definitely one of the main highlights we saw last season. And once again, I already said it by the end of the jumping round, he definitely has some great fans out there, otherwise this voting result would not have been possible. And I'm also very sure about that he will enjoy watching this first of many great highlights he has had in his career. So Tino Edelmann, not the fastest cross-country skier, also Bernhard Gruber keeping it not too fast, in this first intermediate section. Edelmann lost 20 seconds to Watabe, Grobaer 10, and also Christoph Biela struggles to keep the gap he has had after departing from the start area. Lost 16 seconds, while as I've guessed before, this first large group, this first large train has been formed. Jason Ami, Chapuy, Brian Fletcher, François Brod, Massim Lahert, and Manuel Feist up in there. And there comes Erik Frenze, one of the closest friends of Akito Watabe, leading the second train. Where we also see Billy DeMong and Johnny Spillane from the United States, as well as Janne Ryynänen from Finland, and also Ivan Panin, who was strong in the jumping vault, finishing 10th, but now dropped already down the order. And also Akito Watabe's brother Yoshito is in this second large group, which might reach the first bigger group very, very soon, as the leader already comes back to the stadium, finishing his first lap. And he surely got the information underway from his coaches that he is on a perfect way for him. The man who climbed towards the top in very small steps and then exploded right after this season, third in the overall ranking 2013-2014, then second in 2015-2016, third in 2016-2017, and then the victory and the Crystal Globe he has won in 2017-2018. He surely had the ambition to win this one day, but he had no idea in February 2012 that he would make it in early 2017, so 5 years later. So Grober and Edelmann have switched their positions, as we see. Lost another 5 seconds to Watabe, so this ship definitely seems to be sailed for them. Christoph Grober still on his own, as the first group became bigger and the second group has split up a little bit. And Biela has to watch out for these guys coming here. Mikko Coxlian on fifth place. Erik Frenzel in this group, as well as Johannes Ritzek and Manuel Feist. Again, the three Frenchmen and the three Americans as well. Mario Seidel also 12th after the jumping round, has dropped to 18th position. But as we pointed out before, this was his World Cup debut weekend, so already a strong result for him to even be close to the world class. There is another group led by Fletcher, Kircheisen and Riesle. Also Mario Stecher is in there. It's a quick race also because the snow conditions allowed it. The snow in perfect shape. With this minus degrees, it easily is to be prepared, but also to be skied. It's fast. Also the service technicians don't have too much of a challenge, as we see here the Italian truck arriving at 2.5 kilometers. Alessandro Pitin, Mattia Rungadia, Armin Bauer, Giuseppe Michieli, and there we also see Lucas Rungadia. Thank you. It may feel like a lonely training, a lonely endurance training for Akito, but still an enjoyable one because he knows what the end result is going to be. Gruber and Edelmann still keeping their pace, which is slower than Akito's. Edelmann seems to have the better skis. He is a bit faster in the flat and also the downhill sections. Brian Fletcher taking some energy, short drink to fill up the energy stores in the body to not get too tired, to keep focus and power. But this group definitely is able to keep the pace high to close the gap to the front runners a little bit. They always can change the leader if they feel it's a bit too slow. There we saw Mikko Coxlian again taking over the lead. And Edelmann selected Gruber to make the pace. But of course they have to worry, they have to take care that they don't drop too much. Coxlian again up in front, also Eric Frenze, one of the pacemakers up there. Jason Lamy-Chapuis on the right, knowing that a victory would be possible for him, but anyway, he took five of them in course of the season, so nothing to worry about, especially considering the gap he has had to Pitin, his worst opponent, or his closest opponent in the World Cup ranking, which was almost 200 points and will even increase on this day, because Pitin is way behind and has to fight to even get a couple of points. Last point spot is now taken by Fabian Riesle with 1 minute and 52 seconds behind Watabe. Magnus Muhrn in the back of his Austrian colleague Thomas Drumel. They gained both a couple of places, both stronger on the cross-country track than on the ski jumping hill. And for Akito Watabe, it's already halftime. 5 kilometers skied in 30 minutes 52 seconds, so a bit slower than the first lap, but he doesn't really need to give it all. Just focus to keep a good rhythm, to take care of his breath, and always watch out to not risk a fall. Now, as Edelmann is taking over second position again, I'm pretty sure their heartbeat rate is way higher than the leader's one. Especially they know about the situation, about the gap to the back. Then comes the group led by Erik Frenzel, Nico Coxlian, Jason Labrie-Chapuis, Billy DeMong, Johannes Ritzek, Taylor Fletcher, Willy Denifel, Johnny Spillane, Christoph Bieler dropped to 12th position, also Jan Schmid, François Bro, and with bib number 20 we see Miroslav Dvořák, the currently best Czech, also in this group. He looks focused, but he doesn't look too tired after all. Bernhard Gruber still in the tail of Timo Edelmann. And also his record of successes. So impressive. 7 World Cup victories, 27 podiums in total. Olympic champion with the team in Vancouver, bronze in the individual, world champion in Falun 2015, and so on and so on. The list is long, as impressive. Team world champion twice in Oslo 2011, so one day, which is hopefully still a bit far ahead, we can definitely say, wow, we have watched a legend in Nordic Combined. But this is actually valid for lots of athletes we are seeing in this field. Of course, Akito belongs to that. Jason Lamy-Chapuis already retired, but also amongst those still active athletes, Erik Frenzel, Johannes Ritzek, also Mario Seidel, definitely, Taylor Fletcher, Jürgen Grobak, Alessandro Pitin, they all have made great things happening in their career, also for the sport. And Gruber, as he once again pointed out this past season, wants to continue doing Nordic Combined at least until the Olympics 2022 in Beijing, so another 2 years at least. I still like to excruciate myself, Bernhard Gruber said about his motivation, and let's be honest, if we didn't see this phase of focus, determination, but also suffer anymore, Nordic Combined definitely would miss something, as well as this kind man, always happy, always polite, Akito Watabe. So, this large group now has connected to Gruber and Edelmann right here. We also see Sebastian Lacroix coming closer to this group. So, this is going to be a very interesting last lap as soon as the gap has closed. Also, Billy DeMong still very, very strong. Up in fourth place right now. Right behind him we see Erik Frenzel. So a very large group fighting for the two remaining spots on the podium, we will see for sure. So Coxlian, Gruber, DeMong, Edelmann, Frenzel, Denifel, Lamy-Chapuis, Ritzek, Fletcher, Schmid, Spillane, Lacroix. So 12 athletes fighting for two spots, as François Bro has dropped down to 15th position. and Christoph Bieler to 14th. Jürgen Grobak leads this next group with Gudmund Storlin, his country fella, right on his tail. And there we see Tim Hook fighting. Still in his 26th position. So kept his rank after the jumping round. Janis Moorweiser, the young German, Yoshito Watabe, Thomas Slavik and Manuel Feist conclude the points ranks for now. But are they going to make it to the end? I'm doubting it, because in the back we see Thomas Brummel and Magnus Mohan coming up, and they surely have some reserves in their energy stores. So the third of the four laps is concluded for Akito Watabe with the same pace pretty much as the first one. So that's how you split your race with your tempo and your reserves. It's a masterclass in, let's say, administrating the status quo. And this is a tough day at the office for the Italians. Armin Bauer, we saw there, as well as Lucas Rungaldir. There we see the back of the field, Philip Orta, actually 46th after the jumping round, now 49th. And the tempo in this group has increased, so it got split. Sebastien Lacroix, Jan Schmid and Johnny Spillane have dropped out of the group. So now it's 9 athletes fighting for 2nd and 3rd position. And these athletes here fighting for the best possible results. Also Björn Kircheisen with a good performance after being 39th after the jumping. So he's definitely aiming for a revenge after a non-successful first half of this race. He still doesn't look too tired after 3/4 of this event, as I see someone lost a pole right there, or has dropped it, I'm not sure, because the German official is quite hectic there. But now the fight is on. Billy DeMong ahead of Mikko Koxlien, Johannes Rützek, Brian Fletcher, Erik Frenzel, Tino Edelmann and Jason Lamy-Chapuis. It's impressive what Mikko Koxlien has been doing all the way from the start until now, always making the pace and doesn't seem to be tired yet. So hopefully he won't have to pay his efforts with a small collapse in this last lap. Also Willy Denefe still trying to keep the contact to this group, even though the pace is getting higher and higher with every second this race is lasting. It's been a long weekend for all the athletes, with the penalty race on Friday with yesterday's team sprint, even though not all of the athletes have been taking part of that. But still, especially this penalty race was one of a kind. There everyone also did one jump, which resulted in the starting order for the cross country. Then the jumpers are required to reach a certain distance in there, hitting the so-called O-line at 128 meters. Then the best jumper starts 10 seconds ahead of the rest. And then penalties were awarded in 5-meter steps. So you get told how many penalty laps you have to race, which you have to do at the end of every single lap. But also this short explanation is a little complicated, which was also the reason why this competition format was not existing anymore after the season 2012-2013. It was a try, it was an adaptation from biathlon, but too complicated for all of the spectators. So, the tension in the fight for the last medal spot is increasing with every second. Billy de Monge still up front ahead of Nico Coxlian. And Johannes Rützek, as the other guys right here seem to not be able to follow them. Erik Frenzel, Brian Fletcher and Tino Edelmann. Also Jason Lamy-Chapuy has lost a bit, but like I said before, for him it's not too bad. He will extend his lead to second positioned Alessandro Pitin anyway. So, the main question is answered. Akito Watabe takes his first of many, many victories in his career. 18 in the World Cup. But the second most important question will be answered in a very few minutes. Who is going to take second position? There we see the group which is fighting for it, coming up the hill. It's Billy de Monge on the right-hand side and Mikko Coxlian. Johannes Rützek still in the tail, supported by Ronny Ackermann, the jumping coach. And now only has one chance, just to stay in the back of them, trying to refill a bit of energy in the small downhill section, which is coming shortly before the finish, and then it is on a sprinting final for rank 2 and rank 3. But this guy right here has reached great success today, delivered an awesome performance, not wasting any energy that was needed, and celebrating his first World Cup victory. It's Akito Watabe winning here in Lago di Tesoro as Coxlian and De Monge fight for second and third spots. It's Coxlian finishing second and De Monge finishing third. Three different nations on the podium, which also rarely happens these days in Nordic Combined. Johannes Rützek finishing fourth ahead of Erik Frenzel. And Tino Edelmann, three Germans inside the top six, not too seldom that happens. And Brian Fletcher, second best US-American on rank number 7. Jason Lamy-Chapuy finishing 8th. And Vinnie Denefe on ninth position. And the last spot in the top 10 is taken by another Frenchman, as we see. Sébastien Lacroix reaching the finish ahead of Jürgen Grobak, Jan Schmid, Bernhard Gruber, Taylor Fletcher finishing 14th, and Marius Stecher climbing to 15th. From rank number 30 actually, so very impressive job by him. Jörg Kircheisen and Fabian Riesle, another two top 20 finishes for the German team. Maxime Lahoeur and François Bro could not resist the pace dropped down the order to 21st and 22nd. Magnus Mohan climbed up to 25th. And Christoph Bieler lost 20 positions, finishing 24th. And the last 2 points results were awarded to Thomas Strommel and Yoshito Watabe. And 3 happy faces on the podium we will see, that's for sure. But that was a fast race actually. Great quality in the skiing. Lots of fights all the way in the result list. And if Akito Watabe had a second slower lap as he had in the second lap he concluded, this would have been much closer, but he just did everything right in terms of tactics, already using a bit of experience he already had in the age of 23, and became the well-deserved winner in this very interesting classic live rebroadcasting from us. So only 8 more athletes to reach to the finish line. Of course, we will stay to the end and also show you once again the flower ceremony from then, or the victory ceremony, I should rather say. Alessandro Pitin only 46th.
Very hard race.
A bitter day for him in front of his home crowd. He surely was hoping to deliver a nice performance to make his countrymen and women happy, but it wasn't meant to be. Anyhow, this was his best season in his career. 3 victories, all 3 in Schonev. It was a very, very strong period in his career. A different path took Akito Watabe.
One question regarding interview. Do you need, because ZDF, German TV...
As we look on the final result. So a strong result for Team Germany, even though they couldn't score a podium result. But it's still nice to see so much mix inside the top 30. So many different nations, so many different names. And especially to remember those great days some nations has had. Just take the US Americans, for instance. They have had an awesome period of time. The year after, they won the bronze medal on the normal hill with Taylor and Brian Fletcher. Also Billy DeMong finished 3rd in this event, and not to forget Todd Ludwig. Golden days of US Nordic Combined we had. Mikko Koxlien took 2nd place. Your winner, Akito Watabe, slowed a bit down on the finish straight, obviously, took his time to celebrate. And this is the new World Cup standing, so it's a comfy lead for Jason Lamy-Chapu, whilst Akito Watabe has closed the gap to Alessandro Pitin to just 1 point. So that's definitely going to be an interesting second half of the season. Mikko Kokslien and Tino Ilman have been switching positions after this weekend, thanks to Coxlian's second place today. And you also see lots of athletes in the World Cup standings. Six athletes in total scored World Cup points. So we are also waiting for the first words of Akito Watabe being a World Cup winner, as he already spoke to Japanese journalists. And for Jason Lamy-Chapuis, it was another good weekend. Nothing his opponents could do on his way to another overall World Cup victory.
Congratulations to the first ever victory for you here in Val di Fiemme for the Decabe World Cup. Very strong in the jump hill today, and it seemed like a good race.
Yeah, thank you. My jump was perfect. My jump is, I have never start first place before after jumping, but it was very great day, and cross country was, I just think I keep my own pace, but a little bit fast in first round, and it was very hard, more than I thought.
Yeah, because you were actually gaining on the rest of them for the first lap, like you said. Looking forward to the World Championships here next year. This is a great start for you and for your team, and also for the rest of the season.
Yeah, yesterday team sprint was fifth, our team, and I could get victory today, and I think would be great in next in Val di Fiemme World Championships.
Congratulations again, and good luck for the rest of the season.
Thank you.
There's not too much to add on this short interview Akito Watabe has had with our nowadays race director Lasse Ottesen. Bit surprised that he was mentioning the pace on the first lap. He didn't seem to be too tired, but in the end, he pointed out that it was maybe a bit too fast. So he could have saved some nerves, but in the end, he took the victory. This is what not only matters for him, but also for the result list, obviously. And surely he was enjoying the moments that were about to come up. Right now, the victory ceremony here in the finish area in front of the crowd, which still was staying with us, and obviously also with the journalists. Cold day at the office for them, but very enjoyable in this surrounding with this weather, and great stories to write about. And it definitely was a nice experiment to try to think how was it back then, and also to imagine how would everyone think about this, if they knew what was actually happening, or also what it actually means, especially in the retro perspective. Because if you experience it in this very moment, you most times don't really understand what it was all about and what it actually means. And actually, most important aspect, what was yet to come. I mean, in Watabe's case, another 17 World Cup victories, still counting. 67 World Cup podiums he has collected until today. And there we see a happy Billy DeMong, the history maker, you could call him. Probably sponsored by an Olympic city with a Lake Placid. Mikko Koxlien, 5 medals at World Ski Championships. And knowing that he didn't take one here in Val di Fiemme, this second position definitely is even nicer to have. And in the background we hear his teammates cheering for him after a great day. The jump was perfect, like he said, that's definitely the truth. And the cross-country race, maybe if it sounds a bit harsh, but was as good as he needed it to. But the level of this cross-country race was super high. I mean, he started with that, setting the pace, gaining immediately on his opponents, and in the back lots of great fights took place, and we have found well-earned podium winners as well as well-earned point results for everyone inside the top 30, especially on this very last day, as we are listening to the Japanese national anthem right now.
We stand up for the national anthem of Japan.
Well-deserved applause for all of them. And with that being said, we are slowly, very slowly, coming to the end of this first Classics live broadcasting. It was a pleasure to guide you through this event, and I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. It already started with the idea, but also with the research, which events we could offer you, could bring you. If you're a fan of ski jumping, make sure to participate in the current poll, which is going on between Matti Otamäki's victory in Pragelato in 2005 or Tom Hilde's maiden victory in Predazzo, so also here in Val di Fiemme, from 2008, which will close on Tuesday at 12 a.m. And the next Nordic Combined poll will start the week after and end on Friday the 22nd of March. I can't tell you which events will be in there, but if you enjoyed this one, also make sure to participate in the poll for the next one, as well as tuning in, and then I hope to see and welcome you soon in there, but also, as I've mentioned before, also take a look to the sites to cross-country skiing or alpine skiing as well. And then we all hope that you are staying healthy and safe. Enjoy your day, take care, and hope to see you very, very soon. That's it from my side. Luis Holoch thanking you for your interest and signing out. Until next time, bye bye.